Hello, everybody. Okay, it's 8 o'clock. It's time to get started. Hey, just to give you a quick idea of why I've done this course is because schematic reading for HVAC technicians is probably one of our biggest Achilles heels. Nobody really understands it. There's not even our textbook. While we have one decent chapter on schematic reading, it kind of dives right in the middle. It doesn't take a lot of time to explain very much. So I thought we might want to take a look at a little more detail on this. So this is the a new course, a new part of the HVAC training that we have. So feedback is appreciated. I know some of you are not to the schematic reading part yet, but I'm recording this video for future reference in case you don't get it all tonight, and we'll be having this webinar, live webinar, again a month or two down the road when the newer students get up into the electrical portion of the course. So a couple of things for the new folks. Some of you have heard this all before, but I do a lot of screen sharing, a lot of drawing, and so forth, and the chat window that you can see there, I can't see it when I'm in the screen sharing. I just get a little ding in my ear to let me know if you have a question. So if I'm going through something and you have a question, go ahead and type it into the chat window. I will hear that, and so know that when you do that, I'll hear it, and we'll take breaks periodically. I'll go back, review the questions, and then I'll catch you up. We're going to try and keep this between 40 minutes and an hour, because I know it's 8 o'clock at night, and just sitting there listening to someone talking gets sometimes a little boring. So we're going to keep this moving tonight. This is part 1 of 4. All right, we're going to go into the screen sharing here. You should be able to see what my screen now, and we're going to get started. Okay, so reading basic schematic diagrams is what we're going to be learning in this series of lessons. Tonight we're going to talk about schematic symbols, schematics and pictorial diagrams, legends, and then the power line switch and load. If we have time, we'll do a very simple window air conditioning schematic to kind of get your head into this so that you get ready for the walk-in coolers and the air conditioning that we're going to do on the subsequent weeks. Okay, so when you are out working on any air conditioner, whether it be commercial, AC, or residential, somewhere inside one of the covers, you're going to find a diagram similar to this. Sometimes they're in greater detail, sometimes you can't even read them. So that's where your iPhone devices and iPads come in handy, but that is where your schematic and electrical diagrams will be located. Now this is a pictorial diagram here. This is what, when we get done with this, our course, and when you get done with the HVAC technician course, we should have gone through this enough where you're going to be able to decipher what this pictorial diagram is. In fact, when we get done with this course, we'll come back to this, and then we'll start to puzzle things out. All right, so why do you have schematic diagrams? Well, when you open up a simple heat pump, this is what you see. And for you to start trying to figure out what's going on in this big rat's nest of wires, It's difficult. You can do it, but it becomes very difficult to understand what's happening. So what you'll find on the inside cover is the schematic diagram over here that is your roadmap to what you see over here. This kind of helps you find your way without having to start chasing wires throughout the system. Okay, let's get started here. Very simple schematic that we're looking at here. This would be something like the fan that you would have running on a warm day to cool your home. It's plugged into the wall, goes to the goes to the light switch, and the light switch is on, fan motor runs. Switch is open, fan motor stops running because we've disabled power to the fan motor. So that's the most basic of basic schematics, but this is called a made circuit when the switch is closed, and this is called an open circuit when the switch is open. So this is open or this is a closed or a made circuit. All right, series circuits. Couple of things you have to look at. We'll talk about these schematic diagrams over here or symbols a little bit later. Pressure switch, low pressure switch, and thermostat. But what you need to remember is with the series circuit, there's only one path for our current to flow. And it goes through all the switches to this electric motor. If any one of these switches opens up, it breaks that circuit and the electric motor stops running. So it doesn't matter which one of these breaks or opens, it's going to disable the electric motor. It could be one, two, or all of these will disable the electric motor. So a series circuit is in HVAC is usually a control circuit. So this is a very simple schematic here as well. So if the high pressure switch opens up, you lose power to the electric motor or the compressor, which will save that electric motor eventually. If the low pressure switch opens up, it breaks that electric motor. Or if this thermostat is inside of this motor and the motor starts to overheat, it's going to break the circuit to the motor as well. So usually your protection and control devices are in series. So if any one of these three opens or breaks, then it's going to kill the power to whatever load that it's connected to. Okay, here's another example of a series circuit. So now we have parallel circuits. Now remember, we talked series circuits. The controls are in series with whatever motor that it's running here. Parallel circuits have loads, for example, a light bulb, a fan motor, and a compressor, and a heater like you would plug in, like a milk house heater with electric strips in it. These are all connected in parallel. So let's say this light bulb burns out. Well, we're still going to get power to the fan motor, the compressor, and the heater. That fan motor can burn out or overheat, and we still have power to the compressor and your heater. So parallel circuits usually, if not always, power a light bulb, a fan motor, a compressor, or some type of load. And we'll get into this in a little bit more. You'll get this here in just a bit. So when we start to talk about schematics, we have series parallel circuits where we have a series circuit between this thermostat and this condenser fan motor. That's one circuit. Then we have another series circuit over here. But each one of these circuits are in parallel to each other. So whatever happens down here this circuit down here has no effect up here, and vice versa. So parallel circuits, they're independent of each other. Okay, so before we can get too much into reading schematics, you really need to understand schematic diagram symbols, and we're going to go through those tonight. Now, we'll review and we'll talk about series and parallel circuits when we start to get into the schematics, but I just want you to be aware of that. All right, so this download's available on the website. If you don't have it right now, you can always get it. This is for reference only. the thing to remember is many of the manufacturers use these type of symbols here, but they're not always the same, and you'll see that in one of the examples. So this is a good reference, but this is not the Bible. If you go to, if you have a good schematic, you're going to have some of your schematic symbols labeled down here on the bottom of the schematic diagram. Otherwise, you just have to become familiar with what they are. So that's just a this is for reference only. Okay, loads. We talked about loads. They're always in a parallel circuit. And this loads are what do the work in our air conditioning systems. The compressor, the motors, the fan motors, the solenoids, and these are electric strip heats. Loads are what consume power, and they do the work in the system. So let's take a look at some of the common schematic symbols for loads. You will find there's condenser fan motor, evaporator fan motor, and compressor motor. Sometimes that you can see this as CFM. That's the condenser fan motor. That's the part that's in the outside of your air conditioning system. So you may see ODF for outdoor fan, or you may see IDF for indoor fan, and usually compressor is always compressor here. The other symbol that you might see is they may show the actual windings of a motor here. Just know that when you have one of these schematic symbols, this compressor symbol represents basically the same thing as this compressor symbol, or it could be this symbol. All right, so don't get too wrapped around if it's a circle or it's got the windings showing over here. They'll almost always be labeled compressor or EFM, CFM, and they'll be, and I'll show you how to decipher that here in just a bit. All right? Let me pop back here. Any questions here so far? Everybody's good. Okay. Let's pop back. Solenoid valves. These are usually valves that control refrigerant or water. And inside of this solenoid valve is a coil of wire. And when power is applied, it will open up the valve using that magnetic field caused by that wire. And when power is disabled, that valve spring closes. The solenoid coil part of the solenoid itself is represented by this schematic symbol down here. Now, again, this is only what you might see some of the time. There's going to be other types of solenoid coils that are represented by different diagrams. So, again, this is just a common, very common industry standard, but it is not the industry standard or the Bible, but this is a common symbol for a solenoid valve. Also, when we get to the relays and contactors, the coil that is in a relay and contactor is the same type of magnetic field producing coil in there, and you'll see that that coil part is also represented by this symbol. Now what these all do and how they all work, we'll get into in a later webinar, but right now just know that we have symbols that correspond to certain components. Heaters. almost always your heaters are going to be the zigzag lines here. And they will also designate whether it's a heater, a crankcase heater that keeps the compressor oil warm, or a supplementary heater for a heat pump system. So this heater here would be represented by this in an electric furnace, or if this is a supplementary heater and a heat pump, it would, the symbol would represent that same thing. And then the crankcase heater is sometimes it's just a heater that's wrapped around the compressor to keep it warm. But again, this represents a heat producing load in a schematic diagram. Contactors and relays. We're going to spend a little bit of time on this because on how these work, and these are probably one of the most confusing things in a schematic diagram to understand, because you'll see here in just a minute why that is. All right, contactors and relays. The contactor coil, and remember we had that one that had the little zigzag like this too for the solenoid. This symbol, and this symbol, depending on who, what manufacturer and who has drawn that schematic, all represent that coil of wire that creates that magnetic field when you have current and voltage applied to it. So this is really, I've noticed the newer systems are using this round circle as the contactor coil, which is the low voltage part that creates that magnetic field. This is relatively new, at least for me. When they first came out, I was a little bit confused because sometimes they can be confused with the condenser fan motor symbol, because it has the it's a round symbol as well. These three down here are the energizing part of the contactor or relay. And then the other part of the contactor or relay are the contacts. This is basically a light switch. It's controlled by the, let me get these drawn up here. It is controlled by the contactor coil. So if we apply power to the contactor coil, it's going to either open or close the switch. So the schematic diagram for a contactor or relay is going to have a symbol such as this one here. And it's going to say NO, which is normally open, which means that with no power applied to the energizing coils that we have down here, if you measure between this contact will not allow voltage or current to pass through it, because it's like an open light switch that we have over here. If we energize the contactor coil by applying voltage to it, it's going to take this normally open contact and close it like a switch, like you just flip the switch with your finger, only it is controlled by the voltage that's applied. All right, so let's go over that again. So normally open contact is not made, doesn't allow power to pass through it here when there is no power applied to the coils. So no power, this contact is open, no power goes through, no current flows through. Now a contactor and a relay can also have a normally closed contact, which means when there's no power applied to this coil, this contact is still closed or made, and it does allow current and voltage to pass. This is pretty confusing here, so stay with me on this. So, normally open contact, no power applied to the contactor coil is open. Normally closed contact, the switch is made, no power applied allows the voltage and current to pass. Now what happens when you apply the control voltage to the contactor coil? And we'll forget about this right now. Both of these contacts can be in the same relay. So you can have a normally open contact and a normally closed contact. When you apply power, which is usually 24 volts, to the solenoid coil of the contactor relay, the normally open contact will close. The normally closed contact will open. So that won't be there. So this one closes, this one opens. You remove power, and they go back to their original state. All right, we'll review this again because the contactors and relays are pretty confusing sometimes. So normally open, normally closed, that is designated by it represents the relay and contactor with no control voltage applied to it to energize it. And then when you apply power to the contactor coil and energize it, these change their state from normally open to normally closed and vice versa. So here's an example of a de-energized, no power applied. This is our coil right here. It creates that magnetic field that switches the switch on the contacts. With no power applied, we have terminal three is normally closed, one and two are normally open. Now when we apply power to this, the normally closed number three contact opens and the two normally open contacts, one and two, close. So you can do quite a bit of switching and changing and turning things on and off with relays if you understand them and know how to wire them. What you'll find a lot of times as you get into the commercial refrigeration, there won't be any schematics and you'll see relays and contactors wired in aftermarket that you have to figure out. So this is a good thing to remember with your contactors. So let's take a look at, a contactor up close. This is from a residential condensing unit. And what we have with our contactor here is power applied down here at the bottom. And this is a straight through bus bar. It passes power all the time through this leg of the contactor. Sometimes you're going to see this configuration right here over on this side, and these are the contacts themselves. And if you turn this sideways, these are like the points on a car, and they're going to be like this, and then you're going to have a little pad like this, and there's going to be a space in between them. When we apply power to the solenoid coil, which are these two wires right here, it creates a magnetic field that pulls those contacts down, and then it allows the power to flow through the contact. And then that energizes the condensing unit outside. Underneath this black section right here is a spring. So when the power over here is removed, then that spring pops these contacts back open and de-energizes the condensing unit outside. So what makes contactors a little bit different is usually the control voltage to switch them on and switch them off is a low voltage, usually 24 volts on residential systems almost always. It's 24 volts. So that allows your thermostat on the wall not to have high voltage and high current flowing through it. It's got a minor control voltage. So these are the connections for that solenoid coil in there that creates a magnetic field that pulls these contactors into place. And what that does is it allows low voltage to control high voltage, so you have 24 volts, switches that switch on and off, and it allows 240 volts to come through the contactor from the circuit breaker and your house power in this direction. Make sense? Questions? Type them in if you have them. Okay, so here's what makes contactors and relays difficult. And especially with the schematic diagram, if you look at the solenoid portion that causes that magnetic field to close the contactor, and these two wires right here to do that are represented, see that little squiggle line right there? Remember I told you that sometimes that contactor does it? Or sometimes the schematics have a solenoid coil that has the contactor solenoid that looks like a little zigzag line. So here we have the solenoid coil over here, but here is where it's represented on the schematic. Then if we take a look at this leg of the contactor, that's represented over here. And if you look at the switched leg, the one that goes up and down when the power is applied to the solenoid coil, that is up here. So we have one component in the condensing unit that is located and represented in three different places on the schematic diagram. So you really need to be aware of that, because almost all the time the contacts are going to be in a different place on the schematic than the coil. And here's we'll go into the legends, but K1 stands for the compressor contactor right here. So that K1 is related to K1 terminal 1 compressor contactor, and this is just a straight through bus bar, but you can see here it says compressor contactor, but for whatever reason they didn't put a K1 down here to let you know that it was related to that. This is one of those things where you really need to practice reading your schematic diagrams and not getting intimidated. So let's look at this, how this works. One thing I want you to know about schematic diagrams is when you're looking at the schematic diagram over here on the right-hand side, this shows all of the switches, all of the relays, everything that is in the system with it at rest. Power applied from the wall, it's ready to go, but nothing is running. So if you walked up to a system, this shows you, for example, with this contactor, that K1 is normally open. That's a normally open switch. So with no voltage applied to this contactor, this K1-1 is normally open. Straight through bus bar, and there's your solenoid coil. So what happens when we apply any type of voltage, and that will come from the control board and thermostat, to the solenoid coil? Remember, the normally open contact closes, and that causes power to be applied to this circuit, and the system will start running. This is a more complex circuit. This is a defrost control board. We do that. We will have a class on this, but this really illustrates quite well how contactors and relays are one component in the system, but represented by three different symbols spread out across your schematic diagram. So don't get too too worried about that. You just need to know that that's how it is and start looking for those when you're looking at a schematic diagram. Any questions on contactors and relays? We're going to start tracing schematic diagrams in part 2, 3, and 4 in detail. So just we're going to do our components and each symbol. Okay, motor starters, you won't see this very often unless you get on some big commercial units, but this is the schematic symbol for the motor starters. If you notice, they have normally open contacts, normally closed contacts, and the motor starters are the same as a contactor, except they have a overcurrent protection device in the system, which will break the circuit. These will open up if a motor's locked up and drawn too many amps, it'll open up this overload protection. This is usually a heat-activated device, and when it overheats, these metal contacts, they'll compress a little tighter, and they'll pull apart, and then you don't have any power passing through. All right, so you won't see this very often. 5 or 6 years down the road, or if you go to work for a large commercial company. These are on multiple horsepower motors. Okay, temperature switches. These are used quite a bit in heating and air conditioning. So this controls any type of load based on the temperature rise or temperature fall. So what you could have is, in this example, we have a cooling thermostat and a heating thermostat. So this symbol right here indicates that this is a temperature-activated switch or device. They're both the same over here. But what you're going to notice is if the temperature or the cooling thermostat increases, then it closes this switch. So as we see the temperature increase, you have to look at this little backwards S here, opening up a little bit and pushing up the contact and closing that switch or making that circuit. And then if you look at the heating thermostat, if the temperature increases, it pushes it open even more. But if the temperature falls, then it starts to pull down in this direction. So what you'll see, you'll see this for outdoor thermostats or any type of thermally operated switch in a HVAC system. This is what you're going to see. Now remember, you could have for whatever reason the manufacturer decided, a normally closed switch. Here that's going to open up as the temperature rises. And what you'll find is when they draw that, it'll be like this, so that when you have when you're going to know that if the temperature falls, it can't close anymore, but when the temperature rises, it's going to open up that switch and vice versa. So this is your symbol for a thermally operated switch. This is with in its normal position with no power applied to anything. All right. Transformers, this is where we get our control voltage for. This is the symbol almost always you're going to find. I don't know of any other symbol that you're going to see besides this for a transformer. You may see it where these two lines are not represented in there, and you'll just see the coils that are represented here. And again, how all of these work in detail, we'll get into when we get into the components of an air conditioning system. Pressure switches, you'll find this sometimes in systems where they have an air conditioning system for a server room has to cool a room when it might be 40 degrees outside or 30 degrees outside because of the computers that are in that room, and they, or an elevator room where they have to keep all the elevator controls and motors cool. So this is used to control an air conditioning system based on system pressures and just turn on and off. You'll also see this for in commercial refrigerators and freezers. This is similar to your temperature switch, but it has a slightly different symbol on the bottom, and these open and close based on pressure. So this one opens on rise to pressure. This closes on rise and pressure. So if the pressure drops, this opens up. If the pressure rises, this opens up. And you can see on this one here that if the pressure increases, it can't close it any more than it is. It's not going to push it through and open it up here. So you know that if this temperature falls, or I'm sorry, the pressure falls, it's going to allow that switch to open up. All right, you'll see a lot of this on residential air conditioning, high pressure and low pressure switches to protect the compressor. And you also see it in the server room applications and so forth. Okay, legends. All schematics are going to have a legend, and it's going to help decipher what you're looking at. Remember I told you the indoor fan motor may be represented by IDF or whatever symbol or designator that the manufacturer determines. But fortunately with a legend, it says that IF represents on this one the indoor fan motor. So let's go over here and let's take a look at, oh, there it is right there, IF, indoor fan motor. And then we have the indoor fan relay. So listen, you got to remember now that we have the indoor fan relay. So it may be in several different places. Let's see if it is on this one. There's IFR, indoor fan relays, pins 2 and 4. Somebody help me look for this here, because I can't find it now. Okay, we will hang on to that one. Let's take a look at the contactor, same as the relays. So let's look for the contactor. That's the M for the contactor. There is normally open M. There's another normally open contact M. Let's see if we can find the M. There we go. There's our M solenoid coil. Oh, there's our indoor fan relay coil also. These, if you'll notice that the indoor fan relays and the contactor energizing coils are on the 24 volt side, and they operate the contact switch are on the 230 volt side over here. That's why you're going to see them in different parts of the schematic. Okay. Overload protection here. Clear this off a little bit. And here it is, overload. Remember, those are the two components that when they overheat, they open up, and then when they cool down, they'll close. Oh, there's another overload right here. High pressure switches. High pressure switch, normally closed high pressure switch. Low pressure switch, normally closed low pressure switch. So legends give you a lot of information, and eventually, when you see HP and LP, you know what they're talking about. IFR is a common acronym for indoor fan relay. But again, the legends will be down here at the bottom. And if you're lucky, it's going to show the symbols that go along with them as well. The other thing that you'll see is, this is difficult on this one, but field power means that's the power that's wired into the system from the circuit breaker box or the disconnect. Factory power is anything that comes pre-wired from the factory with your high voltage. Field control would be wires that are wired in for control wiring, for example, from the thermostat to the outdoor unit. Factory controls are the internal wiring. A lot of times field power will be a dotted heavy line, and field control is going to be a light dotted line, not so heavy line. And you'll see that on nearly every schematic. Okay. So we kind of have an idea of this schematic symbols that we represent. We got to put those all together for a schematic. So what you have to have for a complete circuit, and for this anything to do any type of work, is you have to have a power. You have to have power. You have to have line, which is our wiring. You have to have a switch to turn it on and off, and a load to do the work. So the power, in this instance, are represented by L1 and L2. You may see L1 and neutral, or if it's three-phase, it'll be L1, L2, and L3. Whenever you see the L1 and L2 designators on a schematic diagram, this is where the field power, or where the electrician hooks up the power from the home to the equipment. So if you don't have power, nothing's going to work. So you always have to have power connected and represented for a circuit. The other thing you need to have is a switch, because that's our control, because usually your switches are controls or safeties. They are going to make or break the circuit. So here we have a close on temperature rise thermal switch. So if the temperature rose wherever this thermal switch is, it's going to close, and it's going to now provide power to the load. And the load is what does the work. So it's just our compressors, our fan motors. Solenoids are a load also. And think about it, they do the work because the solenoid is what closes the switch on contactors and relays, or opens or closes a valve on a water or a refrigerant solenoid as well. So a complete circuit, and for the circuit to work, you have to have the power, the line, the switch, and the load. If any one of these things are missing or not working, this circuit is not going to work. If we have no power and the thermostat closes this switch, the compressor doesn't run. If we have power and the control switch never closes because it's bad, we don't have power and it doesn't run. If we do have power and the control switch closes and the load is bad, it doesn't run. Or the line, which is the wire, if the wire is burnt or broken, all of these can be working properly, but still the circuit doesn't work and the compressor doesn't run. So all three have to be present for a circuit to run, and that is how you start to break down your schematics, looking for the load, the power, the line, and the switch. Okay, so there's our representation of the load. This tells us, not all the time will you see this, but this is 240 volts, single phase, 60 hertz. It's about all of our air conditioning equipment will be 240 single phase 60 hertz. And again, we start to break down our series and parallel circuits. And now that we know a little bit more about schematic, we have our, on this one, we have COMP as a compressor, and there's our normally open contacts on either side of the compressor. And this is the solenoid or energizing part of these two contactors up here. So let's take a look at this. We have our power here. We have our line here. We have our switch here and here. We have our load right here. One complete circuit with everything that we need to make that circuit work. So let's forget about this circuit here. That can be completely blown and not operational. And we have, let's take a look at this blower motor. We have power coming in through our wires, which is our line, through the blower relay. There's our switch. There's our load to the other side of the power, completely independent. So what we have here is we have the line, the power, the switch, and the load. All right, now this just so happens to be, must be a manual switch. So very simple. Here is our contactor coil to energize the contactor. And here is the blower relay coil that energizes the blower relay that controls these contacts up here. So we have our power. We have our line. We have our switch, which in this case would probably be a manual switch if you flipped it. The contactor coil and the blower relay coil are your loads. And that completes the circuit. So here we have three complete circuits that have, and they all have the four things in common: line, power, switch, and the load. Questions? I don't hear any dings. Is everybody still awake? Okay, so as you start to get more and more into schematic diagrams and they get more and more detailed, you have to break it down like we just did over here. This is a very simple, you'll never see one like this. But you may see something like this, very, very simple. Break it down simply circuit by circuit. So let's look. We'll go quickly. Power. When I say line, just assume that's the wires, because if they're broken, that's going to break your circuit. There's your switch, normally open contact. There's your load. There's another switch. Back to the power. We have our power, the line, the indoor fan relay, indoor fan motor, the load. There's that. Here we have the control relay, high pressure switch, low pressure switch. What's the CIT? Compressor internal thermostat. So if it overheats, it opens up. And we have a contactor, which is the load. And we go down here, we have another switch. It's the control relay. And this is the crankcase heater, which happens to be a load. So we have, in this case, several different circuits. But again, they all have that one thing in common, the power, the line, the switch, and the load. And usually when something isn't working, you're going to know that because, remember, the compressor, the loads are what do the work. So when one of the loads isn't working, you're not going to get air conditioning, or you're not going to get heating, or you're not going to get the fan blowing, and that's usually where you start, and then you have to start chasing down your power line switch, see whether it's the power of the line, the switch, or the load. Okay, the line power is, just remember this, that when the line power is applied to the schematic diagram, and you're looking at the schematic diagram as you see it right here, this is with the power applied. That means the circuit breaker is good, and nothing, it's not calling for heating or cooling. So if you just walked out to your air conditioning system at your house right now and it's not running, and you looked at the schematic diagram, that's what it represents. The contactors are open because we are not calling for any type of heating or cooling. The crankcase heater may be heating if you're in a colder climate. High pressure switch, it would be normally closed. A low pressure switch is normally closed. And the compressor internal thermostat is normally closed. So this is what your system looks like at rest. Now, when things get powered up and pressures are out of whack, or temperatures are out of whack, or you're just looking to turn on your system, then all of these switches will start to change. We'll get into that in parts 2, 3, and 4. All right, getting ready to wrap it up. Okay, window air conditioning. Let's take a look at this. We'll go through this slowly. So you need four things: power line, switch, and load. This is how our air conditioning sets with power applied. Nothing happening. You walk into the room, the window air conditioning is off. So let's take a look at the legend. Here's CS. What is that? That stands for that. That's a switch. It's probably the switch that you turn it on and off with. FM is your fan motor. C is the compressor. And T is the thermostat. Remember, this is a wall window air conditioning unit. That's how it sits. So let's take a look. We have our power. Comes up to the switch, but this switch is open. So what would you expect this fan motor to be doing right now? I just want you to think about that. And then let's follow it this direction. Does it go? Will our power go to power the fan motor, or will our power go to power the compressor? It won't until you go in there and turn that switch to turn it on. So that's going to be your on-off switch. So let's take a look. Okay, so you have now turned the window air conditioning on by closing this switch. So let's take a look. We have our power, we have our line, we have our switch. And this is has two poles on it. So it goes through the switch to the fan motor. So we would expect, if everything's working properly, that fan motor is running. We also have our power, our line, and it goes down to this part of the switch. It comes down this line right here, and it goes to the thermostat. And in this case, it's really hot in the room, and that's a close on temperature rise thermostat. And the compressor will be running. So right now, if everything's working properly, the window air conditioning is cooling and is blowing that cool air. Does everybody see that? So we have our line, our switch, and our load, two parallel circuits, and the control for this circuit is in series with the compressor. So let's say that our air conditioning system has now cooled the room to where we want it to be cooled. When the room starts to cool off, this thermostat and thermally controlled switch is going to pull this switch open and break that contact. So we don't have that contact anymore. And so what state is this going to be in if the thermostat turns off? Let's take a look. We have our power, our line, our switch, our load, fan motors running. We come down the other half. We have our power, our line, our switch, and the thermostat is no longer is calling for heat because it's open, and we don't have any power to the compressor, so the compressor is off, fan motor is on. That makes sense to everybody? Pretty simple. Schematics start to get more and more complex, but you just have to break it down circuit by circuit. So this is where we're going to stop for tonight. I do want to ask if you have any questions. I want to add before we leave, and then I have a little 4 or 5 question quiz. This is a new course for us, so I need to get some feedback, and I need to get some input from all of you on where we need to improve and where I can help you understand. This should all come together. We'll review what we've just done in parts 2, 3, and 4. So any questions, type them in. Okay, here we go. All right. Here we go. Fire away. A load is an electrical device that does what? All right. So you got that part. Very good. Some of you must have left. Okay. What is the purpose of a legend on a schematic circuit? Oh, good job. Great job. Okay, which of the following is not a requirement for an electric circuit? Probably hammered that one home enough. All right, last one. Got to think about this one. Okay, what does the term normally open refer to with regard to the to set of contacts? Okay, I want you to remember this. The correct answer is both 2 and 3 are correct. So normally open means the contacts are open when there is no power applied, and the contacts are closed when power is applied. So when you're talking of the normally open contact, that is when it is closed when power is applied. Normally open, remember, that means that when you walk out to your air conditioning system at your house outside and it's not running but power is applied, the contacts and everything in there that are designated on the schematic as normally open are open. So just remember that. Okay, so that's it. Any last minute questions, comments? All right, part 4 is in 2 weeks. We'll start we'll start going through little more and more complex schematics, and we will walk our way through circuit by circuit and get to the point where we're doing some heavy-duty schematic reading. At this point, I will give you some brief information on how those each device works, but you're going to be in module 10 or 11 before you start getting heavily into this. So Saheed and the newer guys, don't worry about this. We'll do this again. And after you read the textbook, it'll be much, much more clear. All right. So last chance. We have done 1 hour and 1 minute. I appreciate y'all staying awake and staying with me. If there's anything that you need information-wise, please put it on the forum. I get a lot of emails with questions, but if we put them on the forum, then we can all learn. And I check it several times daily, so you'll get responses rather quickly. All right, I'll talk to you guys later. Have a great week, and see you in 2 weeks.